Here.
Counsel Cogswell?
Here.
Counsel Creelman?
Here.
Counsel Dahlbeck?
Here.
Counsel Jordan?
Yep.
Counsel Pearson?
Thank you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have minutes from meeting number 14, held February 8th, and special meeting number 15, held February 22nd, 1993. Can I have a motion on those?
Move we approve both.
Thank you. All those in favor? 7-0, thank you. We have at this time a period for citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address the council on something that is not on our agenda this evening?
Yes.
Seeing none, we will continue with council reports and correspondence. Do we have councilors who?
Madam Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Regional Waste Services met on the 18th of last month. We had a report of the DEP meeting that Michael and I attended in Freeport, and we had a restructuring for the term of the directors. It won't affect Cape Elizabeth because we'll still have one, but with Gorham coming on board, they're restructuring, and each director will be appointed for a three-year term. That means really to keep the continuity of RWS going, so that if anybody, this was their last year of their three-year term as a councilman and they were appointed, they could serve 2 years afterwards at the wish of the council, even though they weren't council members. So they're working on that, and guidelines for hauling is going to take more than just the one meeting that we had, and it was very informative, and I think we'll get even more done next Thursday night when we meet. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Campbell. Anybody else? Councilor Pearson?
Yes, I just excuse me, I wanted to make a semi-formal announcement, but I'm not going to be seeking re-election. However, this is more to those out there that may be watching and contemplating whether or not they might take out papers to run for this wonderful position. For personal reasons, I'm not seeking re-election. I've got other things that I want to do in my personal life and try to do some ventures here in town. But I'd encourage anyone that has the time or the energy, which doesn't take much of either. Ask Dick Dahlbeck, he'll tell you there's no meetings, but one of them.
That's what I heard.
But it's a lot of fun. You get to understand the way that the municipal machine operates, and it's one way to do a part in the community. And for 3 years, I think it's a good education, and I encourage anyone to take out the papers and do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? And I thank you for that reminder, Councilor Pearson. Nomination papers are, in fact, available from the town clerk. There are two openings on town council. Councilor Chappell's seat. I believe Councilor Chappell has taken out papers already, if I can announce that.
I'm running.
Looks like to me like you're sitting.
I'm not sure which way, but I'm running.
I was encouraged by the fact that your wife signed your nomination papers. And there are two seats up for election on the school board. Nomination papers are due back by the end of the day, Tuesday, March 30th. Good. Got that one right. All right. So I will echo what Councilor Pearson said and encourage interested citizens to partake of this opportunity. I will guarantee you can talk to anybody currently serving on the school board or the town council to get filled in on what some of the responsibilities are. Oh, we have... No. You want to mention that? I don't remember the details.
Yeah, you might ask Ms. Lane to do so.
The Water District.
Water District. There is a Portland Water District election coming up this June, Tuesday, June 8th. The nomination papers will be available in my office on Thursday, March 25th. This position would represent Scarborough, Gorham, and Cape Elizabeth. Jim Jordan, who is from Cape Elizabeth, will not be seeking re-election. It is a five-year term. So I'd encourage anyone who is interested to contact myself and the nomination papers again Thursday, March 25th.
Good, thank you. One meeting I've attended recently was Greater Portland Council of Governments, where a description of the services provided by, available from COG was given to us that evening. This community does use COG services to a fair extent. We use a lot of their data services and their mapping services. We also procure some of our supplies through joint services. The information they passed out that evening indicated that our dues are just over $10,000 on an annual basis, and through their joint services purchasing, we save over $25,000 above what we pay in dues, which I think is fairly impressive. Nice to know that we can have that kind of savings through a regional organization. Later this month, beginning of next month, the council will be having some deliberations about an annual Volunteer of the Year award that is awarded. It is given in the name of Ralph T. Gould. It was established in 1986, I believe. There will be information in the Cape Courier about this. We are this year seeking suggestions from the community for people who have, who could be considered to receive that award. I know we have last year's award winners in the audience this evening, Henry Adams, so he'll be a hard act to follow, but I'm hoping we will find somebody very appropriate to follow you this year, Henry. Maybe you'll come up with a suggestion for us.
Can we ask the son of the prior recipient, Dick O'Donnell? Dick O'Donnell's son.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I can't say that. One bit of trivia, perhaps, but I'd like to share some of it with the citizenry. This was about the museum and the museum shop we have at Portland Headlight. Last year, you may have read in the paper that the combined revenue from those two operations was just over $200,000 over the past year. I found it fascinating that we sold 1,828 magnets. We sold a good 1,000 Christmas ornaments and a good 20,000 postcards. It was a wonderful success, and we hope for that kind of success in the future years, because we do have some debt service to take care of there. Okay. Mr. McGovern, you had something?
Yeah, I just, two quick items. One is we received a decision from the Maine Supreme Court today in the case of Coleman P. Gorham versus the town. This particular case first came before the Zoning Board back in 1989. It was appealed to Superior Court. It was then appealed to the law court, and very pleased that in the decision today, the zoning board's case was upheld, and the particular issue involved the conversion of a one-family home on Bowery Beach Road to a two-family home, and the zoning board felt that the zoning ordinance did not allow that after hearing the appeal, and that decision was upheld. Second issue I wanted to mention was just to thank the crew of the Department of Public Works for the endless work that they've been doing, taking care of the roads. Got a lot of nice comments from citizens coming in, and it's been a real difficult past 40 days or whatever the time has started, and hopefully it'll come to an end soon. Spring is about 10 days away, at least
theoretically.
Solar system, but we'll find out if it ends up being true.
I know Bob Malley and his crews must be doing sun dances by now. Right. They've done yeoman's work, certainly.
Mr. Chairman, I want you to know that in self-defense, I've taken out a box down at the IGA. The number is 6318, in case you want to send me something.
Thank you, Councilor Chappell. I knew I was going to do something. That reference is to an evening that I spent riding in one of the snow plows, and unfortunately, the wing plow, which I was responsible for, did in Councilor Chappell's mailbox. That's why they don't let me ride too often. first regular item tonight is a public hearing on the reorganization of non-department headline positions. Would you like to give an explanation, Mr. McGovern, before we open that to public hearing?
Yes, this was previously on the council agenda on December 14th and on February 8th. It was referred to the ordinance committee and was discussed by the town council at a workshop. It provides essentially that the number of positions that currently report to the town manager would be reduced from 19 to 15. It includes placing the wet team coordinator under the fire chief, the fire police unit directly under the chief of police, the tree warden within the Department of Public Works reporting to the director of public works, the harbor master working with the chief of police, and the sealer of weights and measures being part of the Department of Assessing and Code Enforcement Administration.
Great, thank you. Is there anybody from the public who would like to address this item? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. We will have item 109, which is to consider the proposed reorganization of non-department headline positions and take any necessary action. Motion, please.
I move we approve.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Your responsibilities are somewhat lifted.
Thank you.
Item number 110 was to consider a request for a new sprinkler variant, new system variance for the Stoddard property on Old Ocean House Road and take any necessary action. Since this agenda was printed, we have received a letter requesting that this be removed from the agenda. Do we have to do anything else formally to do so? Okay, I would like
to table.
Thank you.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 79 was tabled at our December 14, 1992 meeting. It was to consider the acceptance of a portion of Jordan Farm Pond Road and take any necessary action. I'd like a motion to remove this from the table.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, this is for the portion of Jordan Farm Road that has been completed by the Greater Portland Development Group. All of the monumentation is in. It's been surveyed. We now have a description. We are still holding a very small amount in the letter of credit just to ensure that the grass continues to grow along the side of the road. It has been inspected by the town engineer, and I would recommend its acceptance.
Thank you. I'd like a motion on this, please.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Councilor Cogswell.
I just want to verify that this section of the road has been constructed as per site plan approval.
Yes, it was.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? All those in favor? 7-0. We have four items relating to special event usage at Fort Williams. Item number 111 is to consider approving the use of Fort Williams Park for graduation of our high school seniors on June 18th, 1993, and take any necessary action. Item number 112 is to consider approving the use of Fort Williams Park for the Portland Symphony Orchestra on July 2nd, 1993, and take any necessary action. Item number 113 is to consider approving the use of Fort Williams Park for use by the Portland Amateur Wireless Association on June 26, 1993 and June 27, 1993 and take any necessary action. Item number 114 is to consider approving the use of Fort Williams Park for the annual Engine One Art Show on September 5, 1993 with a rain date of September 6 and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. The graduation ceremony, there are at least three representatives here this evening. This one involves the use of Fort Williams Park for graduation beginning at 12 noon, I should say, on graduation day, June 18th, continuing until 7 p.m., including graduation and a possible reception following. The symphony one, they're looking for just one concert this year, which is a reduction from their previous three. They're hoping to have the concert on July 2nd, 1993 in the evening. The Amateur Wireless Association is an event that's happened in Cape Elizabeth quite a while. It's a total non there's never been any influence or effect of it. They merely use it for radio communication purposes, and it's happened, it used to happen over at the town farm, totally without incident. It's an organization that's Peter Eastman is affiliated with, who's been a longtime volunteer and assistant here in the community. The Engine One Art Show, again, is an annual event, Labor Day weekend, and sponsored by Engine One, and they're looking for approval again. I should mention that there may have been an impression left in by an article in the newspaper this past week that these may be being done for in any way to raise money. And I want to reassure the council and the public that these are traditional events that the park has been used for, and really don't make any money. They break even, and it's more providing a public service and, you know, enhancing the use of the park as a recreational facility rather than any attempt to make money. Though I should mention, obviously, that I do think the symphony probably makes a profit on that evening, as they have in the past, and the Engine One Art Show also does realize some profit for their activities.
And all of these have been
Yes.
reviewed by the Fort Wilmington Advisory Commission?
They have all been reviewed and approved.
Thank you. Is there anybody in the audience who'd like to speak to use of the fort for graduation? If you'd please introduce yourselves at the microphone.
My name is Harriet Greenwood.
And I'm Brian Jim.
We're the chair people of the graduation committee, and we've been using the fort for 4 years, and we would appreciate being able to use it again because all of our classmates really enjoyed it, and they think it makes a nice ceremony, and they'd like to use it again for their graduation.
Do we have any questions for these folks? Who do we have in charge of weather this year? We've been so lucky. And I know you guys are just going to die if we have to do it in the gym.
Yep.
Chairman doesn't usually make a motion, but boy, this one's really close to my heart. And I have full endorsement from the folks in my household for using the fort for graduation. I'd like to make the motion that we do so.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Go for it.
Have a good time.
They will.
They sure will. Hadley needs to be set, right?
Guaranteed. Item number 112, using the fort for the symphony on July 2nd. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address that? Okay. I'd like a motion, please.
I'll move that we approve the date of July 2nd, 1993 for the Pullen Symphony Orchestra, the use of the fort.
Thank you.
Second.
All those, any discussion? All those in favor? Discussion, excuse
me.
Yes,
yeah. I'm just curious. The last several years, they've used the fort on three separate occasions during the summer. I'm curious as to whether or not our manager has any knowledge about why they're requesting one day this year and not three.
I do have some knowledge, but I'm not too sure that I was told by the symphony the reason that I'm not sure I was told to repeat it publicly.
Uh-huh.
You know, the symphony's not necessarily a public body, and I'm a little bit hesitant to relate that without their permission.
Can you tell us if the other two concerts would be elsewhere, or if there are two other concerts? Is that possible?
Maybe you should call the symphony and ask.
All right. Anyone viewing, then, who was anticipating three events this summer at our lovely fort should call the symphony and find out why there's only one.
Their number is 773-6128, I believe.
Thank you, Mr. Manager.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Councilor Creelman. Any further discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Just one question for the manager, if I may, please. I see they, and I believe it's the same as last year, $2 per car parking. Now, is that to be used just to defray their costs?
No. Now, we charge them all of our out-of-pocket expenses, and the $2 is for general wear and tear on the facility, and that goes into the general fund pursuant to council policy.
Now, is they're going to pay for this parking in advance, or they're going to try to collect it as they come in?
I wasn't at the Fort Williams Committee meeting when this was discussed. In the previous 2 years, maybe even 3 years, definitely the previous 2 years, they've collected it as part of the ticket price. And I would imagine they plan to do that again. If you want to have that as condition of your approval, I don't think that would be a problem.
I would hope it would be done that way so you don't get into the horror show of trying to collect the money on the way in.
Usually they remit us a check afterward.
So would you follow that up and make sure?
Thank you. Do you want the number of the symphony?
Any further discussion? We do have a motion to approve this. All in favor? Thank you. 7-0. Item number 113 is use of the fort for the Amateur Wireless Association. Is there, I'd like a motion on that?
So moved.
Second. Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 114 is use of the fort for the Engine One Art Show.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Fort Williams will be a good, busy place. Item number 115 is to consider a recommendation from town staff to implement a trash carry-out policy at Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. About a month ago, Bob Malley approached me with the suggestion that we ought to institute a carry-in, carry-out trash policy for Fort Williams Park. It had been discussed by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and was recommended by them to at least try it on a pilot basis. Basically, what this provides is that all materials brought into the fort by folks be removed except for whatever they consume on the premises. It would save a considerable municipal expense with our personnel going around collecting the trash. It would also save us on a per-ton cost for all of the trash that comes in that is subsequently taken back outside of Cape Elizabeth. Furthermore, it would encourage additional recycling. Finally, we've had an existing problem in the fort that oftentimes on Monday mornings we find trash that's been brought in from households that's totally unrelated to fort use. In fact, someone within the last 3 hours has told me that when they read about the policy in the newspaper, they're very disappointed because they couldn't bring their lobster shells and clam shells to the fort anymore and dump them in the barrels. It is a fairly common practice that we see being experienced in the warmer months. Under this pilot project, all trash receptacles in the fort would be removed. Thereby, there couldn't be any placement of trash. This was first tried out by the state beginning several years ago in its state parks, and when it was first suggested, I must confess that I thought it was one of the dumbest ideas I had heard in a while. Nonetheless, it has been extremely successful at the state level. Bob Malley and I think Deborah Lane have also both talked to John Scott about the policy. John is the manager of both Crescent Beach and Two Light State Park, and they have not experienced any problem with it at all, and found that people have been very cooperative and helpful. We had expected a problem, and we debated writing to the state about it, and I don't know if it ever did happen, that it might encourage roadside litter as a result of people not being able to leave it in the park, and we haven't found any instance of that. So we see this as an environmentally appropriate way of disposing of trash, and that it encourages recycling. It also does save some municipal expense, and would like to do it on a pilot basis, either for all of the 1993 season or until it's proven not to be a good policy, should that be earlier than the end of the season.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Could we have a motion to begin discussion? Have a motion, then we'll begin discussion.
I would move acceptance of the recommendation to implement a brand new trash carryout policy at Fort Williams Park.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Comments? Councilor Jordan.
I have a comment. I take it that what I have in front of me, is it going to be posted as a policy? Is it going to be rewritten a little bit?
We would actually write up a policy for posting on site based on what you see here.
Well, there's just a couple things. The first one on the second paragraph, I don't quite understand and recommend the policy that all material brought into the fort be removed except those consumed on the premises. Well, I would think the most of it is consumed would be go out with the people, but maybe some wouldn't. But also, I can interpret that as including trash, and I don't think that is the intent. So it will be reworked a little bit, I would hope, at a later date.
Yes, Councilor Jordan.
And my other question is, what would the cost saving be? Would you put somebody onto that? And so,
yeah,
would they have something budget time so we could be thinking about it?
Yeah, I'd be happy. Bob has an estimate, and I could get him. He's at another meeting in the building.
I don't need it tonight. I just want it by budget time.
Yeah. I think there's, you know, 5 to 6 hours spent every week just on picking up trash barrels and running it to the refuse disposal area. It's a considerable amount of time.
Okay.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Councilor Coxall?
He asked my question, which was just that you were going to post this policy.
Yeah, we would write up something.
And publicize it also at the appropriate time.
That's correct.
The spring.
I'm curious about how you intend to get word out about this. What publicity do you plan to use?
Well, obviously, we've already had some publicity. You know, beyond that, because 85% of the people who utilize the park during the prime season live outside of Cape Elizabeth, it won't be the easiest to publicize. But primarily, it will be through on-site posters. A lot of the visitors there are repeat visitors, too. Quite a few of them are from South Portland and Portland. I think 23% of the users are from South Portland, if I remember the last survey. So, you know, other than the out-of-state people, it won't take too long to get the message out. And, you know, the out-of-state people, you know, usually aren't the ones that use it for extended picnics anyway. They tend to be the visitors just in and out to the lighthouse.
I was asking that. My understanding is that the state policy has worked as well as it has because it was so well publicized. Yeah. I think that's going to be crucial if this is going to be successful, that it be well publicized. I'm also curious if there's going to be a trash barrel at the picnic shelter.
We had a discussion about that at the staff level. The initial thinking was yes. Then we had a continued discussion about the fact that it was going to be continued to be used for the purpose of people bringing in trash, and decided that if we're going to pilot it, we should pilot it completely. We also do have a problem at the picnic shelter. If trash is not placed in the barrel, we have a severe raccoon problem. And when people have gone in there late at, if the ranger doesn't check it last thing before they leave, people tend to leave trash on the floor there, and oftentimes we find it the next morning strewn all over the area as a result of raccoons. So we would hope that the picnic shelter would also be part of this policy.
Okay, if that is going to be the case, I hope that the information form about using the picnic shelter would include that information. We are charging people to use the picnic shelter. I want them to be aware up front as soon as possible.
It would go on the form.
Situation. Okay.
And we do mail the form to everyone who reserves the picnic shelter, the rules and regs.
Yeah, you've got a fair number of people, I would imagine, who've already reserved it for this coming
season. We can send them a mail.
I just want them to know about it, because some of those are people who use it every year, and this will be pretty new to them. You know, I know the groups I go with do some cooking there, and we do generate some trash. Councilor Jordan, was your hand up again?
Yes, I just got another comment about you anticipate having some signs made to this and posted in a few different areas over there. Okay.
Councilor Counselor Pearson, was your hand up?
Oh, I'll yield to alphabetically correct.
Well, I'm very supportive of the change in policy. I too was skeptical when I heard about the state of parks implementing this what you carry in, you carry out type of situation, but it does seem from the press I've read that it's worked very, very well. And I just, you know, think it's important to say publicly that that anyone that brings their trash, into Fort Williams to drop it off as if this is a temporary transfer station. I think this is outrageous behavior, whether this is, part and parcel of anyone who is a Cape Elizabeth citizen or elsewhere. And I would hope that anyone who listens to this debate tonight would have it crystal clear that this behavior should end immediately. So I'll be very happy to vote for this this new policy.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson?
as the town manager mentioned, this has created quite a bit of publicity already in the article that was in the Portland paper. And I received a few different calls from people that are educated, or the degree, their background, and their occupation has been in the park maintenance and management field. And they brought up several points that I'd like to share. A is that, yes, it's true that this program has been successful with the state parks, i.e. Crescent Beach and whatnot, Arcadia, and a lot of the other parks, which are planned destinations. And a lot of the people that use the parks, especially such as Two Lights, which isn't necessarily your most exciting, is, in other words, comparatively to Fort Williams, they're not on the same par. Crescent Beach, when you go to the beach, I think that everyone shows up with their cooler. They're planning on doing whatnot, picnicking, having a good time, and they know that they're going to put it back in the cooler and there's a receptacle to take it home. They had shared with me that a lot of the day trippers, if you will, it's spontaneous type activities. Let's pick up a few Italians. Well, let's go to Captain Newick's, pick up a couple of lobster bakes to go, and they go out to the park, and if there's nothing there to throw it in, they'll leave it anyways. Also, a large percentage of the trash, and I don't know how it rates at Fort Williams, but it's been discussed, a large portion of the trash generated is beverage containers, and of that, probably 85% and 90% alcohol beverage containers. And those are very easily left if there's not a receptacle. So I put those words of caution and sort of as a tag along with the signage that the town manager said that will be in place, I ask, is there a policy as far as littering fines? And if there aren't, or if they aren't posted, I'd suggest that they be heavily enforced and increased dramatically. Because I think that if this pilot program does not work, is there any guesstimate of what those costs might be versus the 5 or 6 hours now, an additional cost to pick up trash that has just been left or hidden or tucked somewhere? Are any cost figures available to compare those? So those are just some concerns that were discussed, and I just wanted to share. Thank you.
That's a real valid, and I share some of the skepticism being voiced. Any other comments? I think the one thing, Councilor Pearson, that puts me over the edge in supporting this is that it's being called a pilot program, and if there are problems, that it will be addressed. But I, too, am concerned about the enforcement. It doesn't make a lot of sense to put a policy into effect if there's no way to enforce it. And we'll see how that works.
Did have one. For event, events. Where the heck have I been? For events such as Family Fun Day, Project Graduation, et cetera, will there be receptacles at those events?
For the municipal events, yes.
Okay.
And, in the symphony would require that they remove their own trash and that they take care of that problem rather than us doing it.
Thank you. Anybody else? OK, Okay, we do have a motion to approve this proposal. All those in favor?
So this is a contingent in favor, though, based on the pilot program aspect.
7-0 with two of us having some reservations. I've been reminded it's a pilot policy. Item number 116 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding the floodplain management ordinance and to take any necessary action. Councilor Cogswell?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. We have before us tonight a revised edition of what is Chapter 6 of our ordinance, Code Constructions, Article Number 6, Floodplain Management Ordinance. We've received notification that in order for the town to be in compliance with a national flood insurance program that was adopted in 1987, that we would have to make sure that our ordinance was in compliance. If the community is found non-compliant, then it would be suspended from the program, and those people in town who have flood insurance would lose their ability to purchase it. Furthermore, those who have flood-prone property may experience extreme difficulty in seeking financing with a lending institution if the property cannot be insured as part of a loan condition. The Federal Emergency Management Agency was initiated, has initiated several changes since the major changes to the requirements in 1987. Even though FEMA did not demand immediate action from local governments, they now request that we do update all our ordinances. The following changes have been made. There are two different ones that have to do with references, statutory references. Under 16.6-6-6 and 16-6-10A, the reference would be changed to 30A-MRSA-4452. Subsection A would also be 30A-MRSA-4452. And under B, the penalty section, 30A-MRSA-4452. The other statutory reference would be under section 66-6, coastal ordinances, where the reference is changed under section 1 to 38MRSA-438-A, and under 2, 30A-MRSA-436-A. There also are additional definitions which have been either changed or have been added. The definition for historic structure, substantial damage, development, substantial improvement. And while we were working on this ordinance, we did various housekeeping type of things in correcting the references to different sections. Some of the references in the old ordinance related to the federal article numbers and not to the actual sections in our ordinance.
Thank you. I believe it would be appropriate to have a motion to set this to public hearing for April 12th. Councilor Cogswell?
I move that we set the floodplain management ordinance update for public hearing at our next meeting, Monday, April 12th at 7:30 p.m. here in the town hall.
Second motion.
Thank you. Any comments? And thank your committee for its work. It's a bit tedious going through some of that, but
I
it is necessary.
My co-counselors, Mr. Pearson and Mr. Jordan. That was just another one of our 20-page documents. We have more coming.
But it's only one meeting a month, right? Okay. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 117 is to consider the annual dog warrant and to take any necessary action. Who has this, Mr. McGovern? Dog warrant?
Doesn't this is the annual dog warrant that allows the animal control officer to pick up dogs and to summons the dog owners. I'll get it right. It's been a long week. The dog owners to court and pay fines as determined by district court judges. And it's an important document in that it makes it legal to summons dog owners for allowing the dogs to run at large.
Thank you very much.
I would move the dog warrant.
Second.
Thank you, counselors. Any comments? All those in favor? 7-0. Item number 118 is to consider the appointment of the town's Labor Negotiations Council and take any necessary action. Ms. McGovern?
Yes, it's being recommended that you appoint Linda McGill as the town's Labor Negotiations Council. She would replace Roger Kelly, associated with the firm of Drummond, Woodson, Plimpton, and McMahon. That particular firm is representing Shaw Sprague in a suit against the town, and Mr. Kelly and the firm are withdrawing due to a potential conflict of interest.
Thank you very much. Can we have a motion on this one, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 119 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding proposed revisions to the sign ordinance and take any necessary action. Councilor Coxall?
Yes. We've been working on some of these revisions since October. Part of the reason for our reviewing the sign ordinance is that it has been in effect for about 2 years. The code enforcement officer found a few ambiguities or deletions and wanted us to address those. Also, there was a growing concern about the proliferation of election signs, political candidate signs, and their sizes. When the policy was first written, we were considered that we would not address the issue unless we found that it became a problem. And as you all noticed in October and early November, there were signs of enormous size and height littering the roadsides. So basically what you have before you tonight, I will summarize. Under section 21-1-2, definitions for internal illumination and sign height have been added due to additional regulation. The measurement of the sign area has changed to no longer exclude frames in the measurement of the sign. Section 21-2-1C, a signs limit has been placed on political signs, including a limit on the height of a sign when posted of no more than 3.52 feet. That's so it won't block the line of vision of a driver when they're pulling out in an intersection. Section 21-2-1I, sign regulations for farm and fish markets and home occupation farm and fish stands have been revised. Here, a farm and fish market will be allowed an off-premise sign if there is no frontage on an arterial. This would make more businesses eligible for off-premises signs. Farm and fish markets only, however, if the new road standard classifications are adopted, which are in process of being reviewed by the committee. Section 21-2-1N, this has been added to clearly permit decorative pennants often displayed in residential areas. There was no way for the code enforcement officer to address the situation. He asked for some guidance in that area. Section 21-2-2, most of the revisions in this section shift the authority to issue sign permits from the planning board to the code enforcement officer. Because the standards are clear, the planning board spends only a minimal amount of time reviewing application. It supports the delegation of its review authority to the code enforcement officer. Section 21-2-2C. The new section combines the regulation of home occupation farm and fish stands with other types of home occupations. The number of signs is reduced from 2 to 1, but the size of the sign is increased to 6 square feet per side. This is with the home occupation farm and fish markets only. Section 21-2-2G, this has been added to address all non-residential uses in residential zones, such as medical offices and restaurants. These uses are not home occupations and are currently unregulated by the sign ordinance, which only regulates commercial uses if they are in a business zone. Section 21-2-3. Included above the table, there is a table in the ordinance, is a reduction in the number of days a sign may be considered temporary. The code enforcement officer has recommended this for enforcement purposes. The table has also been revised to reduce the size of a banner and of the message board sign. Section 21-3-1G. This clearly prohibits any sign which blocks sight distance. Section 21-1-3-1H. In addition, temporary message board signs which are internally illuminated will not be allowed. Permanent message board signs which are internally lit will continue to be allowed but will be limited. Section 21-5-2E. This has been added to eliminate any confusion in the authority of the town clerk or code enforcement officer to remove illegal signs. Section 19-3-14E. With this addition, the zoning board is referred to the sign ordinance to regulate factors such as size and height, but still has discretion in reviewing factors such as, but not limited to, the placement, lighting, and construction material of signs. I also want to note that on the chart as was presented to you this evening, we do have a couple of corrections that should be made. Where it says permanent window display, under maximum number it said one. That's unnecessary. Under message board, where it said maximum height, it should be 4 feet. And at the bottom, where it defines what PB is, meaning planning board, that's no longer going to be part of the ordinance. That would have been deleted.
Thank you very much, Mrs.
I also have one more comment. Thank you. Sorry. And then I will. I also want to submit a minority report under Section 21-2-2G. That deals with allowing wall signs for a home occupation in a residential area. The basic philosophy behind allowing home occupations in a residential area is not one of the criteria, is not to detract from the sense or appearance of a residential area. People often have a sign with street number or perhaps their name on a post in their front yard if they want, or a decorative sign of some sort. But if you start allowing home occupations to have wall signs, you start getting more of a feel of a commercial approach. If you drive through any particular areas, neighborhoods or commercial districts, about the only place you ever see a commercial wall sign is in a commercial area. We had quite a debate on that where for 100% we agreed they all should be on a post, and then in the next breath it all turned around again. But I still am submitting my minority report just because of the experience that I've had previously on the planning board and the feeling that most people would have of having a wall sign attached to a nearby house. So therefore, I present these changes for your consideration.
Great. Thank you very much. Could we have a motion, please?
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Coxall.
I move that we set this for public hearing at our next town council meeting on Monday, April 12th at 7:30 p.m. in the town hall.
Second. I'll second that.
Thank you. Comments? Questions? Councilor Creelman?
Well, again, I'm always pleased that our colleagues on the ordinance committee work so hard and produce such tight and helpful documents. I truly am supportive of 21-2-1C with respect to the limiting of political signs. I suppose, as everyone knows, last few years, a maximum of 8 square feet is not a huge sign. And my only question is, when one wakes up you know, in the morning and drives to work and sees that the night before someone has erected a billboard with a fair amount of scaffolding attached. This is a major construction project. This is no longer a sign. Who in the town has authority to dismantle these construction projects? Who will basically take them down?
Usually, do you want to answer it?
I can, we addressed it, the change in the ordinance, because there was some confusion as to whether it would be the town clerk or the code enforcement officer. Now, the town manager may designate someone. The authority goes through the town manager to designate someone to remove them. And that could be the town clerk, it could be the code enforcement officer, the police chief, or public works.
So would there be, then typically there would not be a call made to the obvious political party sponsoring the sign? There would just be a removal of the sign, or how would it work?
If I may, as Council Council has stated, public works, police, I have gone out and code enforcement have literally gone out and taken these signs. Then I do call candidates, particularly if they keep putting them, say, in the traffic islands or ones that limit site distance and so forth. So I do make the, as supervisor of elections, I take that and go one step further to contact the candidates.
Great. Well, thank you. That's very helpful.
Thank you. Question, Ms. Lane. Do you, when candidates are filing nomination papers or sometime in that process, do you make them aware of the provisions of the sign ordinance?
I do in the municipal elections, but in the state elections, because they don't file with us necessarily, then they are not always aware of local ordinances. Mm-hmm. And again, this is something, knowing that this is an our ordinance, I will make the initiative to try to contact those folks or the designees to make sure that they are aware of our municipal ordinance.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. I've got a question on the political signs, the section that Councilor Krillman was just addressing. And Councilor Cogswell and I talked about this earlier today. I just want to make sure everybody has the same understanding of this. When we're talking about limiting the size of political signs, this is all political signs, regardless of where they are placed, regardless if they're on public property or private property. I've had a question posed to me saying, can you legally restrict the size of a political sign if I have it on my own lawn and it's nowhere near the public property? Is that something that the Ordinance Committee has addressed?
And we felt that it was all signs, since we do have a sign ordinance in town, and it is all signs, and particularly if it might block, you know, line of sight.
Mm-hmm. I guess that's the place I have a bit of hesitation to regulate a temporary sign, which a political sign is by this definition.
But we do regulate all signs, temporary or otherwise, in the town.
Yeah.
And they're limited by size.
Okay. Any other comments? Councilor Dalbeck?
Just a question, Councilor Cogashell. On the business signs, would this preclude any business signs that are now around town, as far as you know?
I mean, the changes,
yeah,
that we
have.
Yeah,
the changes, yeah.
The changes, the difference would be message boards. We didn't really have any that were the 64 square feet. As far as we know, it does not. And there is a grandfathering clause already in the sign ordinance that allows the sign, as long as it's maintained, to continue until it needs to be replaced, and they wouldn't have to meet the new standards.
Okay, thank you.
Council Cogswell, you and I also discussed earlier today the section that you have your minority report on. Are you feeling, you made the motion to set this to public hearing as the language stands right now?
Right, and I can amend it.
That's right. I'm trying to open that door, I guess.
Well, you hit out of the questions. I would like to amend that particular section, 21-2-2G, to eliminate the word wall sign under home occupations. I believe it's 21-2-2G. Let me just double check here. Thank you. find it. I'm not sure. It's on. It's really the second page of actual ordinance text.
Why don't you read the entire sentence there as you would like
all
it to
all non-residential be. Uses in residential zones which are not specifically addressed in Section 21-2-1 or Section 21-2-2 above shall be allowed no more than one freestanding or wall sign. The maximum size of the sign shall be 6 square feet per side, or a total of 12 square feet. The height of the sign shall not exceed 5 feet.
And would you give examples of existing situations with this kind of, with this, existing situations of these non-residential uses in residential districts?
Non-residential uses in, would be doctor and dental offices. Mm-hmm. Primarily, a restaurant possibly. Mm-hmm. But those are the primary uses.
Okay.
And what are you suggesting to change?
I'm suggesting we eliminate the word words wall sign.
So you would only allow a freestanding sign, not a sign directly attached to the building.
Right. And I would think if they did have a business interest, they'd be more likely to want it out by the street where it'd be more visible anyway.
Okay, and you've put that in the form of an amendment to the motion?
I moved to amend it, yes.
Do we have a second for that amendment?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? Councilor Jordan, were you?
This is what I heard that night. Go ahead.
But I just want to take it. I mean, the only reason I was against, I shouldn't say against, I was for the wall signs in some locations and some places where a small sign on the side of the building would, to me, would look better than sticking one out on the front lawn and what have you. So I felt they could have that option. And the dentist there on the corner of Mitchell and 77 Ocean House Road, whichever you want to call it, you drive down and you face that building there and he has a sign sitting out on the lawn.
He does have a freestanding sign on the lawn. Right. Councillor Pearson?
I was just, the only thing that if wall were deleted, I'd say just delete freestanding and say no more than one sign. Because I think the way the discussion went was, yes, in most cases, the sign would be freestanding because it wouldn't behoove the business owner to put it on the house. There's very few houses that would be in a location, as Billy's discussed, it would have to be right on a corner or something where that wall sign would even make any sense. However, we also discussed that in some instances, a wall sign properly done would look better than a freestanding sign, which may in fact impede sight distances, and there'd be no other way to put it but on the wall. I don't think you should restrict whether it's wall or freestanding. I think that the appropriateness of the sign would be determined by the business, the location, and if someone didn't like it and let it be known to that business person, I'm sure that it would change by that avenue versus being regulated.
Councilor Cogsell?
There is always the avenue of getting a variance on that or a change of conditional use for something like that, if that particular instance did arise.
Councilor Crammond?
One of the reasons why I feel strongly in seconding this particular amendment is the example of the two signs that we have in Cape Elizabeth. Welcoming individuals to Cape Elizabeth. One is a freestanding up in the tar box triangle area where the memorial stone is that's truly, I think, a welcoming banner for individuals driving down 77 into the center of town. The second sign is, nailed up against the fire station wall over by the cookie jar that, I mean, quite frankly, I don't think probably 5% of the people that drive down the road even see it. And when you do see it, it's just kind of hidden in, to the brick. And that's why I just think that, you know, the wall sign in and of itself, I'm not sure does what it is supposed to do. And that's why I support Phyllis's amendment, even though I know the municipal issue is a bit of an exempt issue in this ordinance language. I'm just using that as an example.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
I guess as I think about it, I like the way it is now. I'm having a hard time in my mind picturing, you know, do you like a wall sign better than a freestanding sign? And I can't see that I certainly dislike a wall sign any more than I dislike a freestanding sign. In many cases, the wall sign is less obtrusive. Fewer people notice it. If that's what they want, and some people might like that, that's fine. From my standpoint, as a resident who might be driving by or seeing it, we should not be overly concerned with the merchantability of the sign itself, but with its appearance. And I can't see a freestanding, I can't see a wall sign having any worse appearance than a freestanding sign.
I have a question at this point, if I may, before you, Councilor Jordan. If we're talking about the maximum size of the sign, that's maximum size, whether regardless if it's freestanding or wall sign. And that
there is a maximum size, right?
6 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
So you could have a 6-foot wall sign or a 6-foot freestanding sign.
2 by 3, roughly.
Okay, Councilor Jordan.
I just feel, and one reason I spoke about it and stuck to it within the committee, is the option should be there for somebody in the location. Why strike it all together? I don't think that we can sit here tonight and figure out that it would be so unsightly to have it on the wall. Now, we got difference of opinion right here already as far as the one over to Engine 1 Station. To me, it's better up there than it is blocking the edge of the road over there. And I think it's too large anyway, but they tell me you exempt a few people, and that's okay, but don't exempt anybody that's doing a business. And I kind of disagree with that. If maybe you don't want the business in the town, I mean, so you restrict them down to something that you can hardly get. And I think the option should be there, so I am going to kind of hold my ammunition and hope somebody from the public will show up. If they don't, I'll cave in, but I'm going to wait until the last minute anyway.
Thank you, Councilor.
I just want to reiterate, if I may, my emphasis is residential, the appearance in a residential area. It's not necessarily the business. It's the essence of a residential area. And that's why I object primarily to a wall sign.
Okay. Question to the clerk, if I may. If we put this to public hearing, regardless of what the language is, does changing that part of the language, if we decide after hearing public comments, we'd want to change it at that time, do we have to re-notice it in the newspaper?
For that
situation. I guess I'm asking you if that's a substantial change.
I defer to the manager.
Judgment of the council.
No.
Okay.
I don't think it's substantial enough to have to.
I don't think it's substantial enough to have to redo the whole thing. I just curiosity question. Any further comments, Councilor Jordan?
I would think it would be a substantial change, in my opinion, whether you allow it on the wall or you don't allow it on the wall.
Thank you. Any further comments? Councilor Dahlbeck.
I just go back and am thinking of two situations that I have seen in the Cape where the person had a business in their home and where they had a sign either by their basement door, which was on the side of the house down by the garage, in a lower level in one case, and in another case up by their back door. It was an informal real estate business, if I recall. There was a sign up by the back door. And in both those cases, that was a lot less obtrusive to me than had either one of them hung a sign out in the middle of the front yard. And I hate to go against the least obtrusive type of sign.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson?
I was just going to say, in a you know, old value sense. Wasn't it when you went into business, you wanted to hang a shingle out? So if you take away that option, where are they going to hang their shingle out?
On a post.
Swinging in the breeze. No, that's just a little aside, but I'm not going to vote in favor of the motion anyway, or the amendment, I should say.
I think the discussion this evening has given me some time to do some more thinking about it. And I think retaining the choice of the location for the sign is preferable. I can think right now of instances, which I had not when we were talking about early today, where I would rather have a smaller sign, the small sign on the building than in a front yard for a number of reasons. All right, we do have an amendment, which is to strike the words "or wall" from this section. I believe that's the amendment.
Or wall sign.
No, I don't think we want to strike the word sign.
No, we know we leave the sign. Freestanding sign. The or wall.
So it would read, shall be allowed no more than one freestanding sign.
We would be Trust striking or wall.
Yeah. Okay, all those in favor of that amendment? All those opposed? Okay, it was 2-5. Any further comment on the main motion? Okay, the motion is to set this to public hearing next month. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 120 is to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding an appointment to the Arts Commission and take any necessary action. Councilor Creelman?
Yes, I'm delighted to put forth this evening the name of Charles P. period M. period Outwin as a member of our Arts Commission, and I have a very complete curriculum vitae on Mr. Outwin, should anyone be interested in his vast experience and credentials to join this committee, and I would recommend him highly.
Thank you. Is that in the form of a motion?
Certainly is.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. That concludes the regular items on our agenda this evening. We do have time again for citizen discussion of any items that are not on the agenda. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address the council? Okay, thank you. I'd entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? 8-0.
This is almost a record.
Thank you very much. Thank you.